Father, you're the only power that can save this world today. Jesus, you're the only power that can save this world today. Spirit, you're the only power that can save this world today. Let's give God praise this morning. We want to welcome you into the house of God. Won't you stand with us as we continue in worship? Psalmist David says, "Oh, how good it is when brothers and sisters dwell together in unity. For there the Lord commands a blessing, even life forevermore." Let's worship him today.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Worship God.
Amen. God's way is perfect. Yahweh's word is flawless. He shields all who take refuge in him. Let's read this aloud together. For who is God besides Yahweh? Ask the animals and they will teach you, or the birds in the sky and they will tell you. Or speak to the earth and it will teach you, or let the fish in the sea inform you. Which of all these does not know that in Yahweh's hand is the life of every creature and the breath of all mankind?
God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time, spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of heart in everything you've made. Every burning star a signal fire of grace. If creation sings your praises so loud. God of your promise, you don't speak in vain, no syllable empty your void. For once you have spoken, all nature and science follow the sound of your voice. And as you speak,
baby.
be seated. My sin, my struggles, my failures, they are ever before me. I know that my sin has left me broken and disconnected from my Creator and from others. And I know that I'm still inclined to all evil. Yet God, without any merit of my own, as a gift of His grace, grants to me His own perfect righteousness and holiness through faith in Jesus Christ. There is nothing that I can do to make myself right before God apart from faith in Jesus Christ. And I trust that He holds my life in His loving hands. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to come before our God by the blood of Jesus, let us draw near to Him with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for He who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, encouraging one another until the day that Christ returns. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. You may be seated.
Good morning. If you're prepared to give an offering today, we want to invite you to do that now. You can give by texting a dollar amount to the number below, or you can also give on our website, thecrossingchurch.com. For those in person today, you can drop your offering in one of the towers as you exit. Growth in our faith happens when we abide in Christ more than just 1 hour on a Sunday morning. That hour is important, don't get me wrong, but there are 167 other hours in the week that you're taking in messages. So here are a few options to encourage you and provide connection throughout your week. First, you can still register to join one of our spring classes. This semester, we're offering Financial Peace University, Managing the Mess of Marriage, and our Discovery class, which is a great option if you're new to The Crossing, because the class is about discovering and discussing the beliefs that are foundational to The Crossing, like the Bible and the gospel. Next, Crossing Women is hosting a conference March the 5th and 6th with author and speaker Courtney Doctor, who wrote the book Steadfast. There'll be a time of singing and smaller group discussion as well. There's limited in-person attendance as well as online ways to participate. Veritas, our college ministry, is back at it on Tuesday nights at 8 p.m. here in the Crossing Auditorium. So if you're a college student in Columbia and you're wanting to connect with friends and get to know Jesus more, this is the place to do just that. You don't have to register, just show up on Tuesday nights. If you need a ride, you can text RIDE to 65201 and they'll get you here. Finally, wherever you're located, a great way to meet an immediate need and to serve others is to donate blood. We know this isn't for everyone, but if you're healthy and able to give, it will make a big impact. The Crossing is hosting another Red Cross blood drive on our campus on Monday, February the 8th. I've given in the last two drives here, so I can personally say that it's a really smooth and quick process, so I encourage you to sign up for a time slot to give. If you're interested in anything I just mentioned, all you have to do is text the word INFO to 65201 for all the details. And now, together, let's listen to today's message.
Welcome, whether you are in person or online, really glad that you're worshiping with us this morning. Let's start our time together this morning by playing a little game. I'll show you a picture of someone, and you try to figure out what faith this person ascribes to. Okay? Should be easy. Here we go. First up, kind of obvious, right? I said it was going to be easy. These are obviously Mormons. You can tell by the way they're dressed and they're on their bicycles. How about this one? Again, easy. A Muslim couple sharing a personal moment when someone snaps their picture. And of course, you can tell because, again, of the way they're dressed. Or how about this woman? What faith does she ascribe to? Well, a Hindu faith. You can tell, if nothing else, because of the bindi, the dot made of ash that's on her head and shares something about her marital status in the Hindu faith. Okay, next and last one, a Jewish man. And partly you tell by his dress, but a big indicator is the haircut. The way his hair is designed is to show his faith, what he believes. So all these people have some sort of sign that gives away the faith they're a part of, whether you know them or not. As soon as you see them, oh, okay, I know that person belongs to that faith. So what is it for Christians? What's the sign that you are a Christian? If someone just sees you, how do they know that you subscribe to Christianity, that you follow Jesus? Is it like Christian t-shirts, Christian haircuts? I got it. I bet it's bumper stickers, right? Because all good Christians have bumper stickers on your car. And if you got the fish, you're for sure in. Maybe not. In 1970, Francis Schaeffer wrote a short little book. Short book, powerful, revolutionary message. And the name of the book was The Mark of a Christian. And what Francis Schaeffer says in this book is that the distinguishing mark, this distinguishing sign that this person is a Christian, well, it's love. The mark of a Christian is love. Not a haircut, not what you wear, not how you vote, but your love. And when Francis Schaeffer wrote that, he just was taking that right out of Jesus' mouth. Because in John 13:35, Jesus says, "By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." Now, to be frank with you, that puts me under the pile. I would much rather the sign of a Christian be how much you know, right? So the sign of a Christian is that I know right doctrine, that I can pass the test, that I've got my theology down. Because if I know that that's how you are seen as a Christian, or the distinguishing mark of a mature Christian, well, it leaves it in my control. And I can take the right classes, I can read the right books, I can listen to the right podcasts. But that's not what the Bible says. The Bible doesn't say it's what I know. The mark of a Christian is by how I love. For a long time in my life, I was sure that the mark of a Christian is by that you are busy for Jesus. You were doing lots of things for Jesus. And so that's what I did. I did lots of things for Jesus. Or at least that's who I told myself I was doing things for. So all my learning and doing and learning and doing and more learning, boy, I must have been a really mature Christian. Not so much. Because while I was doing all that learning and doing, I was also rude, condescending, judgmental, self-righteous, indifferent to the needs of other people. And that point in my life is when I really encountered 1 Corinthians chapter 13 for the first time. 1 Corinthians 13 is a beautiful description of love. It's poetic in how it's put together. And we're going to start a new sermon series today. It's called For the Love of God. And in this sermon series, for the next 9 weeks, we're just going to walk through 1 Corinthians 13, phrase by phrase. Now, even if you're not used to being around church, even if you don't know much about the Bible, when you hear 1 Corinthians 13, I bet you go, that's familiar. I've heard that somewhere before. And let me tell you, I know exactly why you're familiar with it and why where you've heard it. Weddings, right? Because 1 Corinthians 13 is the passage that is most often read in weddings. If you were pulling into a wedding and all you know about it is these two people are going to get married, you'd make a lot of money if every time you just bet that 1 Corinthians 13 is going to be read at that wedding. You wouldn't win every bet, but you'd win more than you'd lose. And there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, 1 Corinthians 13 is a beautiful description of love. But the problem is that 1 Corinthians 13 has become so famous, kind of like Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, or the Lord's Prayer. And we've taken it out of context. And when we take it out of context, we lose what God is saying. It loses its real power. Because 1 Corinthians 13 was not written to be a love poem about marriage. No, 1 Corinthians 13 was a part of a first century letter written to a first century church. And in the context that it was written, this chapter was meant to be a rebuke to that church. So let me see if I can set the scene so we can understand the context and so we can reinfuse the power. We can rescue 1 Corinthians 13 from the wedding service and give it the power that God wants it to have in our lives. So here's the situation. Corinth is a big city in Greece, and Paul is writing a letter to a church in Corinth. So I want to show you where Corinth is on the map in Greece because it helps explain a little bit of the context that's important. It's in Greece, and it's right next to this isthmus of Corinth that connects these two land masses. And because of its location, Corinth became a trade center. It was on all the trade routes. It became this cultural mega center. See, for example, ships that would come down through here, they would stop here, take off their cargo, transport it a few miles on land, put it back in a different ship, and off it would sail to its destination. In that sense, this area functioned kind of like a modern-day Panama Canal. But this place became a cultural and economic power. People came from all over to be a part of Corinth. And what's uniquely interesting about this city is that when Paul was writing to it, it was a pretty new city. See, in 146 BC, Rome came through and leveled Corinth. The city had rebelled against Rome, and so Rome wasn't messing around. They just came through and decimated it. And for 100 years, it just stayed that way. Nobody lived there. And then Julius Caesar put an army garrison in Corinth because he wanted to develop a city there. He knew it was in a strategic location. And when that army garrison went there, when Rome got behind to building a city there, well, the population exploded. People from all over came to live there. It was multi-ethnic, multilingual. The only thing that everybody had in common is that they were self-ambitious. They were trying to make a name for themselves. That's why they were in Corinth. Right outside the city was a temple to the goddess Aphrodite. She was the Greek goddess of pleasure, sex, beauty. And there was even a word that was developed around Corinth. A new word was coined. It was to Corinthianize. To Corinthianize meant to live in depravity, to live a life without boundaries. So here's Corinth. Corinth is a dense, crowded, success-oriented, sex-obsessed city where everybody's trying to make it. It's almost as if God steps back and goes, huh, I wonder what the city that's the least likely to accept my message is. I wonder what city everybody thinks it would be the most difficult to find people there who want to follow Jesus. And then he looked over at the Apostle Paul and said, okay, Paul, go to Corinth and plant a church. Nobody thinks a church will work there. So Paul goes to Corinth, just like God told him, and he spends a year and a half talking about Jesus, a year and a half sharing the message of God's kingdom with people, and God does his thing. He works in people's heart. People begin to believe in Christ and want to follow Jesus, and a church starts there. And we learn something about the people who went to that church in Corinth that Paul's writing to. We learn a little bit about him in 1 Corinthians 6. Paul writes, do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Now watch this next line. And that is what some of you were. In other words, the people who made up this church in Corinth had come right out of the city. Before they started following Jesus, they had been running away from Jesus. But you are washed, sanctified, justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. So the people Paul is writing to in this church, they're not like, well, hey, I grew up in church. My grandparents went to this church. They were not people who are used to bringing their Bible study to get candy because they brought it every day. They were not the straight-laced, goody-two-shoes, moral, religious types. It's not necessarily that anything's wrong with that kind of person. It's just not who lived in Corinth. These people had messy lives. Now, here's the deal. They were extremely smart, ambitious, capable, competent, and lots of really good things were happening in this city and in this church. God was at work. But it always kind of goes like that. The places that God is at work often have some of the most problems, because they're reaching people who are far from God, reaching people who have messy lives. People who are far from God are wanting to come and listen to more to the Bible, listen to a little bit of about Jesus. And when they come, they bring all their messiness with them. If you want a pure church, if you want a church without a lot of problems, then what you do is you keep it small. What you do is you don't reach anybody that's got messy lives. But as long as we are reaching people like me and you, people with our own messiness, people with our own baggage, then we're always going to be a church that God is doing a lot of good things in, but of course we have our problems too. It's just the way it works. It's unavoidable. But the problems that Corinth had, I mean, they were big problems. For example, there was division in the church. Some people were saying, I follow Paul, the apostle. And others were saying, well, I follow Peter. And it was as if following Paul or Peter was better than the other. Some people, the real spiritual people, they were going around, well, I follow Jesus. You know, those kind of annoying people who always have the spiritual answer. They were in Corinth too. They were suing each other. So there were lawsuits among the people who went to the church, same church. There was gross immorality. There was unbiblical divorces. There was pride, one-upmanship, so that people looked down on others. And into this messy church, God writes the letter of 1 Corinthians. And in 1 Corinthians, there's this chapter, chapter 13. This is how it starts. If I speak in the tongues of men or angels, but do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I'm nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to be burned, but do not have love, I gain nothing. See, what Paul is saying is that you can have all the spiritual experiences in the world. You can have spiritual gifts. You can be busy doing things for God. You can be for all the right causes. You can know lots of theology and pass the Christian test. You can know your Bible from beginning to end. But that's not the mark of a Christian. It's not the mark of a mature Christian. The mark of a Christian is love. So let's break it down. Go back through it again. If I speak in the tongues of men or angels, but do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. Outside of Corinth, there was also another temple to a goddess named Cybele. And when people worshiped this goddess, they would often bang a gong or use cymbals. And so what people think Paul means here is that you can have all kinds of spiritual experiences, but without love, then your life is just like a noisy pagan goddess worship. It's nothing important to God. Verse 2, if I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, but do not have love, I'm nothing. Imagine being so smart that you can understand all the mysteries of God, all the things that we struggle to understand with God. So you could explain how God is sovereign and in control, but how human beings have real freedom. You could explain the Trinity, how God is three in one. You could explain how Jesus is 100% God and 100% man. You could explain the problem of evil so that you understand all the mysteries of God and you can explain them to us public school kids. You understand it all, but you don't have love? Well, then it's nothing. See, verse 3. In verse 3, if I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to be burned but do not have love, I gain nothing. There's a lot of talk in the last few years about the giving pledge, which is people who are very wealthy, like Bill Gates, Warren Buffett, people like that, have dedicated themselves to and committed themselves to giving away their wealth, both in their lifetime but also upon their death. And anytime people of great wealth give away their money for the common good, we should all be very thankful. A lot of really good things happen because of that. But the Buffetts and the Gates and the people signing the giving pledges, they're not pretending like they're giving all their money. Not at all. They're saying, we're keeping some back for us. You don't need to worry about us. But that's where Paul goes. Paul goes to the point of saying, well, what if you gave it all away? What if you even gave your body to be burned? Without love, that's nothing. A guy named C.T. Studd gave it all away. He lived in the middle of the 1800s. He had inherited a few hundred thousand dollars from his family. And he decided that before he got married, he was going to give it all away. He did that, except he kept back some money for he and his new wife, a woman that he married named Priscilla. But when Priscilla found out that he'd kept back some of the money, she looked at him and she said, Charlie, because that's what C.T. Studd stood for, Charlie Thomas. She said, Charlie, you told God you were giving it all away, so that's what we're going to do. And they gave those thousands of dollars away, and then they went to Africa and served there for the rest of their life as missionaries. Now, a lot of good things came out of their life and out of the money that Charlie and Priscilla gave away. A lot of things, more things that I have time to tell you now, but one of them I'm sure you've heard of. The Salvation Army. The Salvation Army got its start because C.T. Studd said, I'm going to give it all away. And yet God says, even if you give it all away, without love, it's nothing. He also says, if you give your body to be burned, well, in the history of the church, there have been a lot of Christians who've endured physical hardship because of their faith. Even today around the world, there are Christians who still endure that kind of physical suffering because they follow Jesus. In 155 AD, a man named Polycarp died. Polycarp, it's a weird name, but it's an interesting story. He was discipled or mentored by the Apostle John. He was a leader, a really prominent leader in the church, and he was 86 years old when the Roman government came and said to him, you must either recant your faith or be publicly burned in the stadium. Polycarp asked for a few hours to pray, and at the end of it, they brought him in to the stadium, and they said, either recant or burn. 86 years old, here's what he said. 86 years I've been his servant, and he has done me no wrong. How can I blaspheme my king who saved me? You threaten me with fire that only burns for a season, and after a little while is quenched. For you are ignorant of the fire of future judgment and eternal punishment, which is reserved for the ungodly. But why do you delay? Come, do what you will. C.T. Studd gave all his money away. We have a hard time thinking about even giving half our money away. Many of us struggle to even think of giving a tenth of our money to God. Polycarp was burned alive. We shudder at the thought of a painful death. But as great as those sacrifices are, without love, they're nothing. See, it's not as if knowledge and service and sacrifice are bad. All the things that Paul is mentioning here in these first three verses, they're all really good things, important things for a Christian to pursue. He's just saying that compared to love, they're nothing, because love is better. Love is far more important. Imagine if I told my wife, say, honey, I love you. And she goes, well, how much do you love me? And I thought about it, and I go, I love you more than COVID. It doesn't exactly just roll off the tongue, right? Not one of my more romantic moments. I love you more than COVID. Don't you love everything more than COVID? But if I told her I loved her more than vanilla Oreos dipped in Nutella, then she would know that's significant, right? If I told her I loved her more than the Chiefs being in the Super Bowl, that would be a big deal to her, right? So that's what Paul's doing. He's heaping all these good things, knowledge, service, sacrifice, faith that can move mountains. But guess what? All these great things are nothing apart from love. It's nothing apart from love. Now, most of us, we convince ourselves that we do a pretty good job at loving others, right? So we don't usually pray, hey, God, forgive me for not loving people the way that you love me. We think we're doing okay loving others, and so we don't make kind of in faith New Year's resolutions to love people more in 2021 than we did in 2020. And to some extent, we do love. It's just that you and I, we put limits on our love. We're like, hey, yeah, we'll be generous. We'll give out of our surplus whenever we have a surplus. We'll take care of people as long as it's not inconvenient. Yeah, we'll love people who reciprocate and love us back, right? I mean, if you're like me, it should not be hard to look in your own heart and admit, I have a problem loving people. I need to grow in love. That's what Paul does in 1 Corinthians 13. He doesn't say you, like if you do this or if you do that and you don't have love, then you're nothing. He says I. If I have knowledge, if I have faith, if I sacrifice, but I don't have love, I'm nothing. He's not scolding. He's sharing out of his own experience of learning about his own sinful heart. See, 1 Corinthians 13, it wasn't written for the marriage ceremony. 1 Corinthians 13 was written to show self-centered, self-absorbed Christians that there is a better way to live. It's not meant for a wedding day. It's meant for every day of our life. Here's a few more verses out of 1 Corinthians 13. Just pick it up where we left off. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Those are the verses that we're going to look at for the next several weeks. But right now, I want to ask you to do something that I find to be very humbling and convicting. And that is that we're going to replace the word love with our names. Okay, so when you see a blank, put your name in there. Because I'm standing up here, I'm going to put my name in. But you think of your name, all right? Keith is patient. Keith is kind. Keith does not envy. Keith does not boast. Keith is not proud. Keith does not dishonor others. Keith is not self-seeking. Keith is not easily angered. I mean, you just can't even read it, right? I mean, I'm not even going to finish it because I'm embarrassed to hear it. Because I know my own heart. Everybody who knows me knows that this is not true of me. It's not. But I bet you this. I bet you and I are alike that when we read our name here, we're convicted, but we want it to be true. We want to love other people like this. And we want to be loved like this. So the good news is that Jesus gives us a better way. Because let's replace love now with Jesus. Jesus is patient. Jesus is kind. Jesus does not envy. Jesus does not boast. Jesus is not proud. Jesus does not dishonor others. Jesus is not self-seeking. Jesus is not easily angered. Jesus does not keep a record of wrongs. Jesus does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. Jesus always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. Jesus' love is a giving love. Anne Lamott tells a story of an 8-year-old boy whose younger sister, she was 6, was dying of leukemia. And she needed a transfusion immediately to keep her alive. And they were looking for a blood match. They asked her big brother, their son, 8 years old, if he would be willing to get tested. He said, sure. They found out it was a match. They asked him, would you give some of your blood to your sister? And he said, let me think about it. I want to think about it. So he goes to bed that night, and he wakes up this next morning, and he goes, okay, I decided I'll do it. So as Anne Lamott tells the story, they go to the hospital, and 6-year-old girl's on one bed, and 8-year-old big brother's on the other bed, and he gives her some of his blood. And then after it's all finished, he's resting, and the doctor comes over and says, how you feeling? And he says, fine, but when will I die, doctor? You see, he thought he was giving all his blood. The reason 8-year-old needed to think about it was because he thought he was going to have to give his life so his sister could have life. Jesus loved us in that kind of way. He gave all his blood so that we might have life. We're going to share in communion together. It's a sign of God's love for us in Jesus, but it's also a reminder of the kind of love that we want to show other people. Now, it turns out you have to do a communion a little bit different when you're in the middle of a pandemic. And so that's what we're going to do. And it's our first time trying this. I'm sure it will be a bit clumsy, but I'm sure also that God cares more about our heart than he does that we get everything exactly right. If you're participating in our worship service online, I hope you got word and have crackers or juice, wine, bread, something like that available. If you don't, let's don't freak out because we're going to be doing this for the next 8 consecutive weeks, so we'll get the hang of it eventually. If you're here in person and you want to give to the Mercy Fund over the next 8 weeks, whenever you leave, you can put some money in the basket on your way out. On the night before Jesus was crucified, he was sharing a meal with his disciples, And he took a loaf of bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body. Take and eat." And so if you will grab your bread and just hold it for a moment. The bread that we break is sharing in the body of Christ. Let's say this together. We are one body and we share one bread. He took some wine and Jesus poured it into a cup and said, "This is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins." The cup that we share together unites us as brothers and sisters in Christ. And together we say, we have died together. We will rise together. We will live together. To close our service today, I want us to say the Lord's Prayer together. This is how Jesus taught us to pray. Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Thanks so much for participating in the worship service with us today. It'd be a big help if you would take your trash and when you head out the door and throw it away. If you want to give to those in need, the offering baskets are in back. God bless.